everyone here knows Commissioner Shea. I can tell by all the highs. And so she's been instrumental in getting us to this point where a bond advisory committee was formed. And I just thought I would have all the commissioners come in and, you know, sort of give us their view of the task ahead. So welcome, Commissioner Shea. It's funny to say that to you.
Thanks so much, John. And thanks to everyone here. We all really appreciate the service that you're providing to the community by serving on this bond advisory committee. And you've got a short run. I mean, you've got to get a lot done in a short period of time. So we really appreciate it. We know you are giving of your time, and that's a precious thing, and your experience as well in the community. So thank you all. I think there's a couple things I want to convey in addition to my gratitude. One is you have a difficult task of deciding among a pretty large list of needs and a very limited amount of money that we have available for the bond election. You know, our grasp is always larger than we can actually get a hold of. So that $350 to $450 million range is real. And I don't envy your task. You got a lot of choices to make and a lot of, you know, difficult kind of trade-offs. One of the other things I want to emphasize is something that I think is a new part of the charge, which is to have really meaningful conversations with the communities that are asking to have their projects put on the bond election. Because we've had a difficult, I'll just say a difficult experience in the last bond election with projects that we all believed there was a great deal of evidence and data for the need. And it's particularly in the realm of the impacts to the community of climate change. We had more areas that were low water crossings that were flooding frequently and were endangering people. We had situations like at Steiner Ranch, where you have 20,000 plus people living in a community that has only one way in and out. And we saw in 2011 with the fire out there that people were trapped. And so we believed that we had items, and we actually, one of the trade-offs that we did was we put those items, because we believed they were health and safety items, on a, I don't know if we call it a CO list, but it wasn't discretionary. We felt these were sort of mandatory things. And in the end, I think they were set in a separate column from the larger list of bond items, but it was part of what the previous bond committee discussed. And when we went to the community with these projects, I think we batted zero on like four or five projects. Three, Lick Creek, Steiner Ranch, say it out loud again. Might have been a Great Divide, or not Great Divide, but Vail, no. Great Divide. So it was three, and I thought there was more than that.
We shelved three.
And we shelved three? At any rate, the conversations with the communities are really important. We've had now, for instance, many, many meetings with the Thomas Springs neighborhood, because what we felt was an important bicycle trail in that community turned out to be something that the community really objected to the way it was implemented. So I think the conversations with the community, which we've added as part of your charge, are hugely important, so that people really, really understand what the project will involve. And that adds another sort of task to your list of tasks. But I think it'll be incredibly important, and I think it will be rewarding to have more meaningful conversations with the communities that will be either affected by or benefit from the bond projects. And then there's the whole equity issue. When I got on the court, I don't know if it was the 2017 bond election, maybe it was. Y'all can remind me. The one where initially the soccer fields in Pflugerville were not, was that 2017?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I'm still sort of a junior commissioner, right? And I find out that Precinct 2 has the smallest percentage of bond projects, and that the soccer fields in Northeast Metro Park, which are really heavily used. I don't know how, if you've been out to that park. It's actually an amazing park. We've got a BMX track. We've got all kinds of fabulous things. But the soccer fields are really heavily used and needed to be upgraded, but it didn't make the bond list. And people in the Pflugerville area were sort of like, what are we, chopped liver? Why is this not on the list? And the community kind of rallied and organized and made the case that their project should be on the list. So there's this sort of unspoken sense, I guess, that there should be some equity among the four commissioners' districts in terms of the bond projects that get selected for each of the areas of the county. So you've got a lot of competing interests, you know, a lot of things that you've got to take into consideration. But I really, really appreciate the service that you all are providing, and I wish you much luck. And I'm happy to take any questions if you have any, John, but that may not have been part of what you allotted time for.
I mean, if anyone had something real specific and quick, have at it. Thank you so much.
You're off to a great
for
start.
Coming out. It's good to see you, and it's, you know, we value your thinking, and obviously that's going to factor into the work ahead.
Great, and we have phenomenal staff here.
We know that.
I can't say enough great words about our staff.
We.
But should you have any questions for any of the commissioners, I'm sure I speak for all of us to say please reach out, because we're more than happy to weigh in and to give you our thoughts if there's anything that you're wondering about that you need commissioner guidance on. Anyway, thank you all.
Thank you so much.
You bet.
All right, why don't we move to public comment and start with the first person that signed up, and that would be Hayden Blackwalker. Welcome, Hayden. Sure, sit here, and that way they can pick you up in the recording, and so we'll give you 3 minutes. Have at it.
Okay. Hi, I'm Hayden Blackwalker. Nice to see some of you again. Nice to see staff here in force. I was on the 2017 bond committee, so I know how you feel sitting where you are. It's kind of like drinking from the fire hose, but it's a really interesting process, and you learn a lot during the process, so best of luck. I wanted to talk a little bit about safety. I understand that you guys are going to be setting up criteria for how you select bond projects, and I think that's a great idea. I'm a transportation nerd, so I just wanted to highlight that safety in the transportation system is really important. The city of Austin and some other jurisdictions, San Antonio and Houston, have what they call Vision Zero programs. And if you haven't heard of Vision Zero, it's the idea that no one should have to die in the transportation system. And it's about how we design our roads. For many years, we took highway standards for very high-speed roads and applied them to county roads and neighborhood roads. And we can fix that. But as you go through and think about these projects, I would encourage you to think about those in terms of Vision Zero. In Texas, 10 people a day die in traffic. Sometimes they're in cars. Often they're vulnerable road users. Often people who are walking and biking are also low income and economically challenged communities. So it's also very much an equity issue. I saw the other day that the county and Campo and the city of Austin and some other jurisdictions in Central Texas got millions of dollars in Vision Zero funding from the federal government. And so the county will be creating a Vision Zero plan. So I think if you're thinking about safety in the transportation system and the way these roads are designed, as you go through the process, you'll be a little bit ahead of the county. Yeah, 1 minute. So that's really it. One thing to maybe consider is, instead of thinking about specific individual projects, one of the things the city of Austin did was they allocated Vision Zero money, and then they depended on their staff to go through and identify the most dangerous intersections and the most dangerous roads. Often what you find is that there are a few lane miles of a few roads that are absolutely, that are accounting for a lot of these fatalities and serious injuries. So that might be an approach too. So anyway, thank you very much. It's good to be back and glad to see you all.
Thank you very much, Hayden. I appreciate those comments. Very timely as we start coming up with evaluation criteria tonight. Tom, welcome back.
Thank you. And is this on? Yeah. And it has been so soon since I last spoke here, but the project list has been released, and so I figured that it would be a good opportunity to reflect on that. And I do have comments that are similar to Hayden. So I serve as I'm the executive director of the Red Line Parkway Initiative. We're a nonprofit supporting the 32-mile trail along the Capital Metro Red Line from Austin to Cedar Park to Leander. It goes through both Williamson and Travis counties, including unincorporated Travis County, especially in the Wells Branch area. I also do serve on the board of Safe Streets Austin, a merger of Walk Austin, Bike Austin, and Vision Zero ATX, and did serve on the Bike Safety Task Force the Travis County Bike Safety Task Force several years ago. And was actually part of the group that tried to find low-cost projects for bike safety, including the Thomas Springs Road project. And we knew that when we came up with that project idea, that it was not ideal, and it was, you know, when we came up with that idea, it was gonna be implemented many years later, and we weren't sure what the community conversation was like. Even at that time, we were very supportive of shared use paths, and I really think that that's the way the county needs to go. Shared use paths are shared walking and biking paths. They're fully separated from the roadway. They have broad appeal because that's what makes people feel safe. And a lot of our county does not have access to that. I was part of an effort in adding a sidewalk onto Decker Lane when there was a teenager who was killed several years ago just biking to his friend's house. And as mentioned about equity concerns, there are a lot of families who live in Travis County who don't have the resources to bring their kids to all the locations they need to go. Sometimes their kids do need to walk and bike to places, and the only access they have to those places are to walk along busy country roads. So I think it's important to focus on that. And I do appreciate in the project list, there are a good number of shared use path projects, and I would encourage focus on that, plus also on vehicle passenger safety projects as well. So, and I think that there's a few ways we can get there. Roadway expansions don't always increase safety, and oftentimes they actually make things less safe. So I think that in the roadway projects, we should also be looking at how can we ensure that vehicle passengers stay safe as well. I'll just mention my email address is tom@redlineparkway.org. I'm happy to have individual conversations if you have any questions about what I mentioned, and we'll continue the conversation. Thanks again for your service.
Yeah, thank you so much for coming out, Tom. Appreciate that. Robert, thanks for coming back. And Robert, what you might do is just introduce yourself and, you know, mention the group that you're here representing tonight. Thanks.
All right. Definitely. Hello, everyone. I'm Robert Foster. I'm with Safe Streets Austin, which is a bike, active, wheelchair advocacy organization, trying to make the streets both like safe but also enjoyable. And I'm here to kind of echo their same thoughts and also make it even more complicated for you because you guys don't have enough pressure. But 4 years ago, Austin passed the Austin Strategic Mobility Plan, which was essentially a way that we want to guide transportation in the Austin area over the next like 25 years. And one of the major things that came out of that planning process is that the city wants to see a 50% split between people in cars and people getting around in different ways. That includes walking, biking, public transit. And the main way that they want to implement this aggressive shift is through strategic investments, which is where you guys get to come in. You guys will help decide what is a good investment of our time in a way that can help us hopefully reach those goals. Because in the end, so many other parts of the city will be moving in this direction and the region that people will be trying to get out of their cars. You know, there'll be limited capacity on some of the central Austin roads, which will encourage people to be, you know, to take the bus or take a bike. So I just yeah, I thank you guys for your service and that stuff. I just want you guys to keep that in mind because we want to make this as safe and enjoyable of a city to get around with as possible. And by city, I mean all of Travis County. We know that's the best part. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Robert. Is there anyone else that didn't have a chance to sign up? All right. Well, again, thank you all for coming out tonight. Why don't we do, have all of y'all seen copies of the minutes from the past meetings? You know, I'd be happy to entertain a motion to approve all of the minutes from the preceding.
Move to approve all previous
meetings. Thank you, Andy. Okay, thank you, Gary. Are there any discussions or any corrections to the minutes that anyone saw? All right, if not, then all those in favor of approving all of the previous minutes, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, passes unanimously. Thank you, everybody. Now what we're gonna do, we got our new emails, and you know, I think we're gonna also have our chat board and some of the things. You know, we're now kind of getting tapped into the Travis County communication system, and we're gonna get some training on that tonight. So, Cynthia, I don't know who's presenting.
Joyce.
Oh, Joyce. Sorry, wasn't sure it was you that was doing it. Well, thanks for coming out.
I'm glad to be here.
Good.
All right.
And we've got a handout, don't we?
You should have two handouts.
Okay.
One is showing you how to log in. If you have not done that yet, highly encourage you to do that. Before you do that, the one thing you might want to put your thinking cap on is number two, because if you got your email, you had that very long, unique password, but you're going to have to reset it the first time you log in. And you need to have at least 8 characters. You need an uppercase, lowercase, a number, and a special character. Okay, so it's kind of a standard one, but again, just you want to kind of think about before you log on because you're not thinking that. So what I'm going to first do is introduce you how to get onto email and Teams. And the email, I'm just going to show you briefly and answer questions as I go along because I want this to be for you.
Okay.
So I've got lots of ideas in me, but I want to make sure that it follows for you. So what we've done is you're just going to go to office.com and it's going to look very similar to this and you're going to hit sign in. All right. Or you can click in here and sign in. So what we've done is James helped me, right?
Yep.
And how many of you guys have that email that sent your email address, right? Did you notice there were two email addresses in there?
Yeah.
So technically, the one below it with your last name, first initial, and maybe a number is your official email. The other one's an alias, so it's easier for people to understand. As I told James, I would use the one below if it makes sense because it's a little bit less typing, and I'm an old typing teacher, so I like shortcuts. So what we did is he logged in with either of those emails, and then below that, he already entered in his temporary password. And so right now, we're to send a text passcode. And I think you should have all been associated with, thank you. You should have all set up information for Duo. Duo is our multi-authentication code. Just in the event that somebody were to get your email and password, they can't get past this or they shouldn't be able to. In other words, you should never click on yes, go ahead and do it unless you yourself are sitting at a computer doing something like this. So just kind of keep that in mind. So I'm going to click on send a passcode. Oops, I was afraid of that. Did you get a passcode?
Not yet.
All right. Let me try that again. It may have timed out. That's what I was afraid of. We waited too long. Do you mind coming back over here to log in? Al, could you flip over to a different screen so they can't see his login? just so we preserve that. Thank you. I forgot the dance symbol. Temporary password. And again, remember, your temporary password is case sensitive. So however you have it, uppercase, and then there's going to be a lowercase. So keep that in mind if you haven't already done this and reset your password. All right. Al, if you want to go ahead and flip it back, that would be great. All right. So this will send you a passcode. Did you get it? There we go. And we're logged in. Okay. Thank you. So it should be fairly self-explanatory. Oh, let's. I think we're going to need you to blanket one more time, Al. We got to do some security questions. We'll just do one. My apologies. I wanted you to see it. One that you want.
Just out of curiosity, while she's doing that, how many have already logged in? You did. You couldn't do it.
Do you want
okay.
My,
so not many.
There's your answer.
Yeah, Josh, the only question I have is probably for an IT question.
Okay, let's see.
I have Microsoft.
You may have to select a couple more. Oh, hang on.
Yeah.
It says skip setup. Maybe we can just skip it right there.
Had my work email. And something else, the Travis County email.
Yeah.
So I was scared to redo it so I wouldn't lose my work email. So I just need to talk to to somebody before I actually go through with it.
Yeah.
All, so.
And I'm sure they can tell you who to contact. I'm probably going to have the same issue when I do it.
Yeah. Because it kept wanting me to switch users and I didn't.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you definitely don't want to lose all the rest of your life. Because of your volunteer duty. Right. Oh, sorry.
No, that's fine. I just don't want to interrupt. Okay, so we got past it. You should answer the security questions just so that you have them as a default. I didn't want to pass this up so you could kind of still see that. And then over here on the left-hand side, the two that you're really going to want to focus on. Let me see if I can make that a little bit larger. Give me just a second. How does that look? I know some of you guys are still young, but so over on the left-hand side, the nice thing is you can do this any place that you have a browser and an internet connection.
Thank you so much.
I have some security training on the backhand, so please don't use this when you're going to Starbucks and using their free Wi-Fi unless you have what's called a personal VPN. And if you're not sure about that, don't worry about it, but just stay within a secure network that you're on. Outlook and Teams are the two that you're going to go to. Outlook is pretty standard. Oh my goodness. Doesn't like the fact that we didn't set those up. So we will make sure we set up your secure questions. And then over here, you'll just have your folders. And I don't know how much would you like me to demo, because it's a fairly simple, Outlook, Gmail, anything like that. So I will be more than happy to demo, but I want this training to be for you.
So, y'all just weigh in. I'm personally fine, but I'll leave it. Anybody that's, would like to walk through this, maybe that doesn't use Outlook or whatever, happy to have her go further. Totally up to y'all. Anybody want that? Okay, looks like everybody's comfortable.
Okay, and that's what I figured, but again, I want to make sure this works for everybody.
So this is where you'll log in and all of your when we start corresponding with our Travis County email addresses, this is where it'll all be captured.
Exactly.
Okay, so.
And the one thing, I'm not guaranteeing it, but if you were to try to put this on your phone, Travis County is part of a government tenant, and you can't add it to a standard Outlook. It's very secure.
That was gonna be my question.
So just as an information, you won't be able to add it to your native email or any of those. So just kind of keep that in mind. The best way is to access it through office.com. Okay? So I don't know if that went over any of your heads or if you have questions, but it is very limited because of security.
Exactly. I'm just trying to think. I'm sure because so many of us already know people in the community, we're going to get emails to our personal email addresses. I guess it's just you're going to have to sort of manually, like, reply to that from your, because what I was thinking, you know, the easiest way to probably handle that is if you get something to your personal address, reply from your Travis County address, and then you can, you know, shift the dialogue over to that email
address.
But
you don't have that capability because of the government tenant. So what you might want to do, well, here's a question. What do you want as a standard? Do you want to make sure you're using your Travis County email, or would you prefer using your personal emails? You want them using Travis County? Okay. So that, thank you for that input. So then what I would recommend
Boy, that
do,
got a quick reaction.
That was good.
Because we were all ready to say we want
to use your
personal.
Well, that makes sense. I understand that. Then what I would recommend you do is anything that you get in your personal email, automatically forward it to your Travis County and make that your standard reply. And that way you've always got it in your Travis County email. Thank you, Cynthia. I appreciate it.
Okay.
But that's how I recommend it. If you get it in your personal email, just forward it to your Travis County, then everything will be in one place and you're not, oh, where was that? Was in my personal or my Travis County? So.
All right.
Okay. So we're good with that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come back over here to Teams. And Teams is a collaboration tool that allows you to do many things. And this just keeps popping up because we did not do his security questions. So we're just going to skip that.
And so, is there a number or an email on this sheet of who to reach out to if we have technical drama?
Good question, Sydney. I will let her answer that.
I know you're not going to offer up your email.
On the email sheet that we gave you, the back does have the ITS help desk phone number.
And oh, it's actually best, on the front. It's
oh,
on the,
sorry, it's on the front
the
now. Yeah, and it's normal business hours is the best time to reach them, although there is someone always on call.
Okay, so is it best to call as opposed to trying to send someone an email?
Yes, I would advise that, yes.
Okay.
So here's Teams. You've got lots of different options, but I've been told that we really want to focus on two options. You all should have, when you get into Teams, a Teams channel for your board, your Travis County Citizens Board Advisory Council Committee. We call it CBAC. Is that how you pronounce it? So if you come to the General tab, up here under Files is where Sydney has posted some files and we've got them organized. You can tell that they're new and you can access them. And you see this, I call this your breadcrumbs. So if you want to go back, you could use the back button, but I would rather just come back here and use my breadcrumbs because this is kind of telling me where I'm going. Okay. Would you like me to look into any of these folders specifically? These folders are going to maintain your agendas, your charter, bylaws, presentations, and minute meetings. So these
looks
are
like
more
we're
resources.
Fine. It looks like we're, oh, well,
Teams,
please.
Teams has a chat feature, right?
I'm sorry, what?
Teams has a chat feature.
Yes, it does.
But we shouldn't use that, right?
Oh, Sydney is going to tell us what to do.
I am going to let, yep, I'm here to train. I'm going to let Sydney answer your
sorry,
questions.
Sorry, I'm the open meetings paranoid guy.
We would like for you all to limit your chats to things that are just purely administrative in nature, because your deliberations are going to be here or on your online message board that's going to be accessible to all members of the public.
Okay.
Thank you.
No chatting on, no deliberating on matters in the Teams chat.
Right.
But administrative is okay.
Got it.
Great.
And I guess the one thing I might notice, if I could talk about chat real quickly, is if you are going to start, you got to find your people first. James, I'm going to see. Sydney. All right. Uh-oh. I can't find you. There she is. So when you start a chat, I don't know if you guys are familiar with this. If you need somebody's attention, if you do the at symbol and then start typing their name, it will start populating. And again, let me blow this up just for a second. I'm just not feeling like it's big enough. So as I started typing her name, and what that will do, it will put a exclamation mark and it'll show up in her Teams. And that is a good way of getting hold of somebody. Okay, especially since you guys aren't gonna have this open all day, you know, this is gonna be kind of your extra job. But that might be a way if you wanted to use that. That would be the only thing I might notice. Do you guys have any other questions on chatting or Teams? But I think the main thing you're going to want to do is come over to the Teams channel, make sure you go to the actual general underneath it, and then you go to your files. So it's pretty, just remember that it's not the main name of the channel. You have to go to general, and then by default it may go to posts, but you will see the files right there. So questions on that? Any other thing? You'd like, okay, all right. Then the other thing I wanted to show you was now going to the other handout that you have, and we're going to look at the online message center. And there's lots of ways of getting there. Oops, I just typed on the wrong one.
Is this already up and running?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, it's up and running.
Has anyone logged in to it?
Okay, so it's a little different than my screen showing. It's probably because they used a different browser. But what I did is I had to come over here to these three lines. Some people call it a hamburger. I guess they were hungry when they named that. I don't know. But then again, you know that, you know, eight characters is a bite, and then half of that's a nibble. True story. Anyway, I'm starting to get hungry. I need to grab some food. So we're going to go over to Commissioner's Court and go to Government, and we're going to go to the online message board. Now, personally, if you guys have this in front of you, I'm an ex-typer, typing teacher. Personally, what I would do is I would just type in that URL that's down there and just go straight away. So it depends on which way you want to go. So this is going to log in, and this is a little different because it's going to be your first name, period, and your last name. So it's not going to have your email address, but it is kind of the first part of your email. And then if you have not logged in, there is a, just like logging into office.com, there's a default password, and I have not changed mine. I'm not going to say what the default password is. We don't want it. And I'm going to see if I typed it in right. I did. So then what we're recommending on the steps
is that we recommend the first thing you do so that nobody else can get access to it is scroll down underneath the profile, and you should see where it says preferences. And then down here is where I can reset my password. Oops. And again, it has to have the same characteristics that all of the requirements are listed here that I mentioned before. Let's see if I typed it right, right? Oh, okay. But you get the hint, right? Come down, preferences, put in your password, enter it, and hit save. Let me see if I can do it. Let's see if we can get. I'm over here not typing. All right. Assume it worked. We're going to click on where it says Commissioner's Court, and it's CBAC, right? So there is, it'll bring your form up. Honestly, you know what I would do, and this is how I would do? I don't know if you guys can see. Let me see if I can zoom in a little bit better. I doubt if you can. No, it's just dealing with that. You can type in the URL as traviscountytx.gov/forum/CBAC. And that'll take you right in, have you log in, and to me that's a shortcut. So, and then here you can see some topics. And Cynthia started a topic, and it looks like there's one reply and 24 people have seen that. So I can reply to it. Hang on, I'm having. Okay.
We have a question.
You got to click on the link where it talks about it, and then you come down here, and this is your, right? And you've got a couple of different things, but honestly, you're starting to get a feel for me. I like things quick and easy. I'm going to do a quick reply and say, I totally agree with you. The web team is the ones that provided these great documents. They're part of ITS.
We have one question over here, Rajiv, I think.
I'm sorry.
That's right.
I was following along and I couldn't log in with just the name. So
it's your first name, period, last name.
Okay, what is listed in the email then. Okay.
Yeah, it's not your email. That's what I was saying. To get onto the board, it's just your first name, period, last name. And then you guys have that default password someplace. I think they sent it to you. Were you able to get in?
I'll try.
Okay.
Keep going.
Okay. Sorry. Thank you, John, for letting me know.
Absolutely.
And then the only other thing you might want to do is, depending on if you want to continue to get replies, otherwise you can check it, leave it default. And once I hit submit, if things go right, there's my response. Up here, if I wanted to go back one level, again, remember how we talked about these breadcrumbs up here? So if I want to go back one level, I try to stay away from using my back arrow in the browser because sometimes that works and sometimes it doesn't. So a lot of times I try to use what is there. And so this has brought me back. It's kind of like a folder structure, if you guys remember creating folders, and then you have them subfolders. It's very similar to that. So we still have our breadcrumb. And then if I wanted to create a new topic, create the new topic. Is there any? Okay. I just didn't know if there was any way that you guys wanted to do that. So obviously you want your subject to say what you want to talk about. Underneath here, there's lots of fun things you can play with. This is your font. If you want to bullet, justify, quotes, smiley faces. And you can do hard returns, you can do what you need to, you can create links in there. And then if you scroll down, you can add files. And you can drag and drop them. And I'm doing a lot of scrolling because I've expanded the magnification, so you probably shouldn't have to scroll that much down. And then I can either cancel or I can go ahead and submit. And then if I go back, we should see my exciting test. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. I don't want to spend more time, but I do want to make sure there's any questions, I can answer them for you.
Please, Gary.
So this message will be accessible to anyone that sets up an account?
Yes.
The public would use this?
I didn't hear the question.
He was asking if the public can use this.
So the committee asked for an online forum, and so this is the way that you can be transparent about deliberations. The community will be able to see it, but they will not be able to respond to it. It will just be the committee members that have access to post on it.
Okay. So, but a member of the public, if they could go follow those.
Yes.
To see the dialogue.
Correct.
Great. Thank
yes.
you.
So don't say things you probably don't want there forever, right?
And we may, it might be the type of thing where if there are a lot of questions after everybody spends a bit of time with it, that maybe we would see if you'd be willing to come back once and, you know, just sort of answer some specific things. I know it's totally different once you try it. Any other questions? So really, this is for us to communicate among ourselves about things. So the public can see it.
Don't need to check this for administrative stuff or anything, right? That'll be handled through a different channel, it sounds like.
Yep.
Right.
Teams is your administrative tool.
Okay.
And then, you know, I know it's going to be a pain, y'all, to try and contain your dialogue with the public or anyone else to your Travis County email. Certainly, at a minimum, if you find yourself that you forgot to do that, you need to be sure and collect those. Like, you should create a CBAC folder so any correspondence is at one spot. I mean, really, it's for the sake of if there's a FOIA request, and we had to provide all of our correspondence about our work here. So, well, great. Thank you so much for setting this up for us and for walking us through.
If
how to make use of it.
I guess the only thing I will put out there, I'm Joyce Miller, and if you guys are online during the time, I'm on Teams, so if you want to use the at symbol, I'll do my best to answer you. I used to be the technical trainer at ITS, but I've moved up, but I love training so much. When Sydney asked me this opportunity, I said, you bet I would do it because I miss training, but I love what I'm currently doing. So if you guys need me, and if it's okay with Sydney that they use the chat to reach out to me, please don't hesitate. If by chance I don't respond right away, I might be heads deep in something else, but I will do my best also to help you. So
thank you very much, Joyce. Appreciate your time tonight.
All right. Well, thank you guys.
It's clear that you enjoy training. And then also, I guess, you know, everybody, we just need to sort of make some effort to check in on that every so often. You all feel free to admonish me when I haven't responded to something because I haven't checked in. I'm sure I'll prove to be the worst at it of all of us. Okay. Well, now's our chance to start moving to some of the substantive work of our overall effort. And so let me just maybe tell you how I, like, you know, give you a sense of how I'm hoping to approach this so that, you know, it all logically flows, that we all kind of get to the same place together, and hopefully it makes sense to you. So What David and Charles were going to do, hopefully you've had a chance to look at the project list. I'm sure you probably have. And they're going to talk about like what's in the general categories of projects that are under our purview. You know, road expansion, bicycle safety, pedestrian safety, different types of parks. But they aren't going to go into the individual projects. They're just going to talk at a high level about categories of projects that we're going to consider, that, you know, that we will be evaluating over the course of the next several months. What I'm hoping that will do is give us a foundation to start talking about evaluation criteria. So we'll probably start in on the evaluation criteria tonight. Definitely won't finish it. It'll be a longer conversation. You could even see as people were talking in our last meeting, several things that y'all mentioned really kind of relate to how we evaluate these projects. So I'm hoping that the discussion of the categories of projects will give us a foundation to really understand the project, the evaluation criteria when we move into that. And again, that'll be an ongoing dialogue. And what I will also say is that hopefully we can get to a point where we have some significant percent of that evaluation criteria. And by the way, you know, we will start with what they use. Like, they've already created some priority projects, so we'll start with what staff uses. We aren't going to have to reinvent the wheel, but we can obviously add to that. Some things won't be relevant because we have a different group of projects than we had in 2017. You know, again, as Judge Brown mentioned, this is a bit more about land acquisition than a bunch of smaller county projects, although some of those will be in there as well. So we won't have to reinvent the wheel. We can start with what they have. I'm sure we'll want to add some things. And then as we start really digging into the projects, I'm sure we'll want to revise the evaluation criteria as we move along as well. But there will be a point at which you kind of need to lock in, and that's what we use to move projects, you know, up or down and eventually make the list of what we recommend to Commissioner's Court. So does that make sense to everybody? Any questions? All right, I don't know, is it David and Charles together or just one of you at a time or both, however y'all want to. So what you might turn to, everybody, is your project list, which is going to get really worn out. Thanks, y'all.
Good evening. Welcome. I'm Charles Byrd.
Thanks.
I'm the Parks Director. And I've got Robert Armistead and Paul Naughton from Parks handing out a map. This is really a map of the county park system, all the parks and natural areas, conservation easements, the BCP. It gives you kind of an overview. It also shows you precinct boundaries. So you probably might want to get familiar with this. Yeah. And also highlights the main drainages that we are interested in preserving: Gilliland Creek, Wilbarger Creek, Onion Creek on the east side. And then on the west side, you've got Cow Creek, which is up by Lago Vista, and the Pernalis River in the southwest quadrant. So that gives you kind of an overview of what we're doing. And then you all have been handed this project list. It's got the smallest font on the planet. I can't read it, so I have to use my special glasses to see if I can understand what my public works colleagues have put down here. So do you all have the project list too? Yes?
Yep.
Okay. So you notice that it's highlighted in green. And in the first column, it gives you precinct number that the project is associated with. Sometimes, there might be one or two precincts listed together. That's because the project bridges precinct boundaries. But the first two projects are strategic parkland acquisition and conservation. And if you notice, it's east side, west side. We've split it up that way. And we have decided in this bond, our recommendation in this bond election, in 2017, we had parkland acquisition and we had conservation easements separately. In this election, we would recommend, and it's up to y'all what your recommendation is, we would recommend merging those two funds together, east and west, and it just gives us the latitude to, if we find better deals in conservation easements, we can do more of those. If we find some good land acquisition opportunities, we can do those. But it just gives us more latitude to try and protect more land. And so that's really what those first two lines are about, is strategic park land acquisition east and west. And I can tell you that one of the tracks that we have targeted, we work closely with the Nature Conservancy in many of our acquisitions. One of the tracks that we were looking at, we just found out this week that it's being lost to an 1,100 unit subdivision. So, I personally think that we probably have, the county probably has a couple more bond elections before the opportunity to buy another Reimer's Ranch is gone. So that's kind of why we threw these at the top of the list. They're priority projects, priority for us, land acquisition. And then we have shovel-ready projects underneath that, and those are projects that are designed or almost designed. They're, we either have a set of design plans sitting on the shelf, or we have a project that's being designed that's going to be completed this, by the time this bond election rolls around. So that's what shovel-ready projects are about. And then we have park project priority alternatives, and those are projects that are we've done before. We don't have design plans for them, but we've built projects. And I think Commissioner Shea mentioned the synthetic turf at Northeast Metro. We understand what goes involved with that, the efforts, the design, and we've thrown that in as an alternative project simply because we know the scale of it and about how long it takes for us to do it. So we think it can be done within, a five, six-year window, which is what our planning and budget folks want us to be able to get projects done once they issue bond money for projects. So that's what that's the priority projects. And then we have park projects other, and those are really.
What about priority alternates? I thought that description was just shovel ready.
Okay, so that's what I was just referring to, is synthetic field.
Oh,
we don't
okay.
have designs for them, but we've done them before. And we have a feel for how long it takes to get them completed. They're not as complicated as a full, park build out. You're building one element to a park, like a synthetic field okay. conversion. That's what those are
That's
about.
Priority
they're,
alternates.
They're just
Thanks.
Easier for us to scale and time out versus taking a project that, converting a whole piece of property to a new park.
Got
very
it.
Complicated.
Got it.
And then down in the white, we have outside the green, we have park projects other, and these are just a list of other projects that are on our list.
I think Patrick's got a question.
Oh, just real fast. I wanted to make sure I heard. Shovel ready means, you said like planning, acquisition, and design is all completed, and it's just construction that's left?
Or? Yeah, there's no acquisition. It's just it's an element in a park that we're going to build. We're going to take four soccer fields that exist that have grass on them, and we're going to convert them to synthetic.
Okay.
So we already own the property. That's really what that's all about. That makes sense?
And we'll dig into all those, okay. but yeah.
Timber Creek, here's one. Timber Creek is a project that we did jointly with the Army Corps of Engineers. So we have a set of plans. They're probably in the 80% range of completion. We would probably want to tweak those a little bit before we do it, but it's for the most part designed and ready to go. So that's what that's all about.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Oh, sorry.
Then the other? Oh, you were, I think I cut you off before, as you
I think
started.
The other projects are projects that, they would be nice to do, but we know that money's tight and they really could fall into another bond election, quite frankly.
And you're going to walk us through your master plan when we really dive in.
Next week, if you want to put us on the agenda, we'll talk about the park master plan. Parks does a 10-year master plan, and the last master plan we did was in 2017. It's supposed to expire in 2026. We were actually in the process of updating that one, but for this bond election, it won't be done by that time. And honestly, I don't think the elements in the 2016-2017 master plan are really going to change too much with an update. It's just going to refocus what we're going to be doing beyond 2026.
Right.
So we have an existing master plan, and we will come back next week if you want to put us on the agenda, and we'll do an overview of that and probably tie in the land water transportation plan with that LWTP, just give you a high overview of that.
Okay.
Any questions?
All right, thank you. Okay. David, you want to walk us through
sure.
the multitude of road projects? Thanks, Charles.
Yeah, thank you.
See you next week.
So yeah, now we're into the portion with the roads, drainage.
You might put the mic a little bit closer. Yeah, thanks.
Okay, so this will be, is this?
Yeah it's much better.
The roadways, drainage, the bridges, pedestrian ways, things like that. So what we've done is we put at the top of the list is some highlighted projects, and it comes along with the same sort of theme that Charles was talking about with right-of-way needs. The second one down is TxDOT right-of-way needs for upcoming projects. I think I mentioned that last week as well. It's just we have to coordinate with TxDOT when they do widening or new alignments. We have to either purchase the full cost of the right-of-way or a percentage of it, depending on if it's a new alignment or a widening. So, and we know of several projects that TxDOT is in the works on, so that's why that's on there. A couple of things just to explain real quick. The first item on here is cost overruns. Just to give you an idea what that is, we have several projects where we have federal funds associated with those projects. Typically our cost is 20% towards those projects. We've had some projects that were deferred because of the state, because of I-35 project, and the federal funds were diverted to that I-35 project, and thus some of our projects were deferred, which with inflationary costs, those prices are going up every year, and we are responsible for all cost overruns. And so that's what these funds are for, is the additional cost overruns because they have been deferred and the costs have gone up. The third item on here is a partnership to accelerate TxDOT projects. We found that a lot of times TxDOT's very amenable to, if we supply additional funds, they can prioritize that project higher on their list as well. And so that's why we have that on there. Then we start getting into the different categories. We have the first category is roadway capacity projects. Typically these are projects where we're going to widen a roadway from a two lane to a four lane. You'll notice on column F, we have identified some of these projects as MAD 4, MAD 6. MAD is major arterial divided, so that gives you an idea what a MAD is. And then 4 is four lanes, two lanes each direction. So that kind of gives you an idea what we're talking about. A new category we're going to bring, and this is something that Christy is helping us with, is we call it a Hill Country Corridor, or a Safe 2 road. It's different than what we typically do, and we've been listening to the community about shared use paths and things like that. And so not only do we have the MAD major arterial divider projects, we're also looking at a tweak to that, and we're calling it Hill Country Corridor right now, but that's basically a roadway without curb and gutter, more in the hill country, more rural setting with a shared use path next to it. Instead of having bike lanes on the road itself, they'll be separated on a shared use path separate from the roadway. So again, to give you an idea of kind of the different cross sections of roadways we're looking at. So those are the roadway capacity projects. The next is roadway safety projects. Now, the reason we had these separated out really from last time, 2017 bond project, is because we went out separately for those funds, and we identified a roadway safety project based on some criteria we set forward. Basically, are the accident rates high? Is it one way in, one way out for a neighborhood? Things like that that qualified it as a safety project. And so instead of going to the voters, we issued COs for those projects. That's just a differentiation between capacity projects and roadway safety projects. Roadway safety projects will have a lot more of the turn lane improvements, things like that, based on safety. And of course, this is redundant, but TxDOT improvement right-of-way needs. That was already at the top of the list, but it's down here as well. Then the next category down is bridge safety projects. We have several bridges around the county, and TxDOT does inspections on those for us, and they give us a grade on a bridge, and if it's below a certain grade, then it moves to the top of the list, and we prioritize based on that grade given by TxDOT. We took care of most of those bridge projects in 2017, so these are just what's left over that weren't selected in 2017, but we took several projects and improved the bridges in 2017, so we're kind of not emphasizing too much on that this time around. Then we have bicycle safety projects, and we've only highlighted one right now, but I think we're going to get a lot of input from you guys on different types of bicycle safety project or bicycle projects, and so we're kind of open to what you bring to us on those items, but we do have several listed that we've accumulated over the years. And of course, your pedestrian projects, those are sidewalks. Just to give you some inside info on pedestrian or sidewalk projects, if you're in an existing neighborhood and you're putting in sidewalks, it's typically very controversial because you're tearing up their front yard, which is the right of way, but they consider it their front yard. So keep that in mind. When we start looking at pedestrian projects, we need to make sure we get community input, because they can be very controversial. Then the next are drainage projects. We have drainage projects broken out by either stream crossings or subdivisions. Stream crossings are, like it says, it's basically a culvert or a small bridge that helps with the flow of water under the roadway, so the roadway doesn't flood. And the drainage projects for subdivisions are, we look at an entire subdivision that has maybe flooded in the past or has had damage from floods to residential properties. And so we look at the entire subdivision as a whole, look at trying to drain these subdivisions so the homes are not flooded for future rainfall events. Then the last but not least is a substandard roads projects. What we call a substandard road or an unaccepted road are roadways that were maybe constructed by a developer in the past, but were not constructed in accordance to our standards. They didn't go through the acceptance process, and so therefore we do not maintain those roads. It could be for a variety of reasons. It could have been all the sidewalks were not ADA compliant, and we asked them to fix it, and they just walk away. Or there's all sorts of different ways that we have these unaccepted or substandard roads. Now, we do have a substandard roads policy at the county that takes care of these, but typically we ask the subdivisions to pitch in about 30% of the cost. That's very difficult for a lot of subdivisions. And so some of these on here are some higher priority ones where they're near a school or we need access for several different reasons. And we put them on the list, assuming that maybe we would forego that 30% match from the subdivisions and just fund the entire thing ourselves. And that's why these are on here.
You have cost estimates on those at some point during this process?
Yes, we will. Okay. I do have some cost estimates. We're updating a lot of these cost estimates. Keep in mind that these cost estimates, some are stale. Some are based on 2017 cost estimates before we had some changes to the rainfall intensities, it's called Atlas 14, that affected our drainage calculations. So they've increased in cost because of that as well. So some of these costs, keep in mind, are somewhat stale as we get more and concentrate more on some of these projects that we think we might move forward on, we're going to dive down and get a better cost estimate and tweak it to the point where we feel a little more comfortable. But right now, some of them are a little stale.
Assuming all those are going to go up.
Yes, yeah, they probably will some. Now, something I want to mention, I've broken out the costs, and you can notice on these the different columns, or several different columns, but you have the engineering cost. We also have project implementation, and I want to speak to project implementation and what that means exactly. Engineering cost is, it's pretty simple. You can understand that, but project implementation is a variety of different issues that we might have. Now, in the past, for the 2017 bond, we used what is called a general engineering consultant, or a supplementation of our staff with a consultant to help us go through these projects. That cost, if we do have several projects and we can't manage those internally, we will have to contract out a third-party consultant, and that's about 10% of the construction cost. That's included in this project implementation. If we don't need to implement a GEC or supplementation of our staff, then we won't need that. So as we get further down, we can take that out or keep it in, depending on if we think we're going to get several projects that we can't do in-house. Also in project implementation is our program manager consultant. That is a consultant that helps us track costs, schedules, things like that. That's about 3 to 5%. We also have utility issues. Sometimes if utilities are in the way and at certain times, we will have to supplement the cost of relocating utilities. It depends on where the utilities are when we get into these. There is a cost to us sometimes on those. And then, oh man, there was one more item. John, do you remember what the other item was? Am I missing that on project implementation? We got. Oh, of course, the most important one. If we do have large projects, and we want to pursue a preliminary engineering report, which we had discussed earlier, which gives us a little more insight into hurdles we might find. It helps us finalize the estimate a little better. It also helps us communicate more to the community what the project will look like. That's also in the project implementation. And that this project implementation column is about 30% of the construction cost. It's going to vary depending on if we need the GEC, if we want to do a PER, things like that. So if you have questions about that, that's kind of where that comes from. The rest of the items, right away and construction costs, those are pretty self-explanatory. I think that's it for now. Do you have any questions?
Yeah, please, Amy.
Just to clarify on the cost overruns, the inflation in cost overruns because of the deferral, is that on the 20% that Travis County is matching, or is that on the entire amount?
If there's any cost overruns, the estimates were done back 2016,
right.
2015, and we were 20% of the cost of those estimates at the time. Now that the costs have gone up, the county is responsible for 100% of any cost overruns over what we originally estimated in those estimates. When we made agreements with TxDOT.
On the entire project, not just 20% of it.
Correct, the entire project. And so that really hurt us when they deferred these projects, because now with inflation, it's gonna come back to bite us. And it's not our fault. They had to reprioritize, re-look at those prioritizations for those federal funds, and unfortunately some of ours got deferred.
Yes, I sit on the CAMPO policy board. So we just had a presentation from TxDOT this week of the projects. There's projects that Travis County had that were on the deferred list that they're gonna propose be refunded this year on the UTP. And they were also increasing their number to accommodate for inflation. So I was just trying to figure out if Travis County is having to accommodate for inflation and they're accommodating for inflation.
Well, that's good news if CAMPO was changing those cost estimates due to inflation. I wasn't aware they would be doing that.
Okay.
So that's good to know. And I can check with our long-range planning staff and find out, because they'd go to the CAMPO meetings too. That's good to know. I did not know that.
Well, and timing-wise, the UTP won't get approved until August. And so we wouldn't know for sure whether those projects are going to get refunded until after this recommendation has already been made. But it would probably be helpful to know how much money is actually needed if in the event that they get refunded, because it does look like there's a pretty good push to get those refunded this time.
And I'll check in with that and see where that is, where the discussions are leading. At the time we put this together, we didn't think that they'd be changing those estimates, so that's good news.
Yeah, and it has 620 projects and one on 71, and I'm forgetting the other one off the top of my head.
I think Pierce Lane was one of them too.
I'm not remembering off the top of my head.
Okay, that's our biggest Travis County project. You know, 620 is a TxDOT project, mm-hmm. but we'd be responsible for the right of way though, and that.
Yeah, please, Gary.
Could you talk a little more about the drainage projects and kind of what is, not specific project necessarily, but kind of what the encompassing is? And are there any things that we might think of as drainage projects or in other departments in the county? Are there other places that gets worked on?
Well, the drainage projects would just be on Travis County maintained roadways, of course. And basically, we have a lot throughout the county of several low water crossings that flood at a 2-year storm event. These improvements would bring it to, it would not flood on anything less than a 100-year flood event. So we bring it up, we would raise the roadway or the bridge or the structure so the roadway would stay dry during that 100-year rainfall event.
So y'all look at, for drainage, you're talking about roadway adjacent, or drain, roadway adjacent drainage challenges versus, you know, neighborhood flooding and things like that.
Right. Well, it's the stream crossing under the roadway. Yeah. So it's not, we're not really talking about the bar ditches mm-hmm. inside the road or anything. It's just when a stream or a creek crosses a roadway or goes underneath the roadway, that's what these would be for. They're very specific, small, concentrated projects mm-hmm. just at that stream crossing. But now, the subdivision drainage would be more area-wide of the entire neighborhood, an area that maybe is subjective to a lot of flooding. And so it looks at a more comprehensive analysis of all the bar ditches, stream crossings, everything for an entire community.
So I do want to say, though, that in 2017, we actually had a section of projects that were related to neighborhoods, mm-hmm. not necessarily along the right-of-way. So, for example, Timber Creek. There was a whole list of those projects. The county received some funding to do a study, as well as the court set aside, I want to say it's close to $2 million, Sydney, do you recall? What, Sean? Okay, so we have some funding. We're finishing those flood studies. There will be some projects recommended from those flood studies. There is a pot of money, if you will, and I want to say it's somewhere around the $2 million range, but I'm not entirely sure what will be available to do those projects. So I don't believe they're on this current list for the bond because they are on a separate track.
Yep.
Now, in future bond programs, there may be projects that don't get funded. But those are going to be, we're working with the court in our planning and budget office to see how we can address those issues on an ongoing basis as well. So they may not be on this list, but they are in Travis County. They are in Transportation and Natural Resources. They're under our floodplain administrator.
Perfect.
Thank you. Does that answer your question?
That's right. And so emergency management, does that also include, does it come through TNR, emergency management kind of?
No, so emergency management is, there is an Office of Emergency Management within the county that's under a separate department, but our floodplain administrator who looks at, you know, all of the FEMA maps and you know, permitting development review and so forth within the floodplain or how to mitigate if you want to build in the floodplain, that group of folks is in our development services, but they also are doing the study across the board at all the different watersheds and how they get affected by floods, and then what the recommendations are for, say, residents could be elevating your homes. It could be creating large drainage channels throughout the subdivision itself. We have done one where we've actually purchased some of the properties in order, or sections of properties in order to create that large drainage channel, mm-hmm. so that when there is a flooding event, it all gets concentrated into one major, outpouring of the water into another river or wherever it's supposed to go, as opposed to flooding the entire neighborhood.
Thank you.
So just to be super clear, with these drainage projects for subdivisions, the goal is to mitigate residential structures from getting flooded. Is that right? Maybe.
It's to prevent loss of life and property, obviously. So we have different ways of handling the drainage issues within subdivisions, depending on where they are, what the features are, and how the water, disperses throughout the subdivision as a flooding event occurs. I want to say the funding we got was through the Texas Water Development Board, so thank you to you guys. But that's helping us look at all the major watersheds that have flooding events. And for those of you, if you're not familiar, you probably already know this, but generally things flow from the northwest down across the center of the county and end up in southwest, and eventually, if it's big enough, we'll make its way down to Houston in the Gulf, right? So that's the big swath of area that we're very concerned about, particularly in the southeast. And we're studying all those watersheds that will have experienced a lot of flooding, and we see potential of that. And of course, with the Atlas 14, that kind of raises the bar as to what is considered floodplain. Even though they're not formally adopted yet, they're on their way to being adopted.
All right. So does everyone feel comfortable with kind of a base understanding of the sort of categories of projects that we're going to be looking at? So what we might do, David, is if you can pull up, and so we'll make this matrix available to you. I think the starting point is going to be the criteria that were used in 2017 to evaluate the similar type of projects. What they are going to do is go in and revise this. Staff will apply this more to the projects that we're looking at this year. So there may be additional criteria that aren't on here today. There will be some that are on there from 2017 that won't really apply to the projects we're looking at. So they'll do a revision themselves, but this is going to, just get us started on the types of things that we'll use to evaluate them, and we'll keep working through this, I suspect, a couple of meetings would be my guess, and then we'll probably revise them at various points in time as we become more educated about the projects. So I thought, David could start us with, this is the 2017.
Correct. Yeah, okay. This is what we used in 2017.
Yeah, so just start wherever you want, and this is the beginning of a longer process, so wherever you start will be fine. And then this will be sent to us in the meantime. We'll have it so you can work on it on your own.
And this ties into the project list that we just talked about. We have those ranking numbers. That's where this came from. And on this matrix, it you go to the far right, it kind of gives you your staff recommendation rankings, that kind of thing. But what we did is we had several categories we wanted to look at. One of the ones, the big ones, is meet safety definition.
Is there any chance of zooming in on that? Because we don't.
Sure.
It's probably more important to see what's at the top than it is.
Exactly.
What's below. Since we don't have a hard copy.
Right. Yeah. It's kind of hard to follow. So basically, all these are the different categories. Meet safety definitions.
And this is for what type of projects? Just this obviously in parks. What are we, is this for roadways?
This is for roadways, drainage, pedestrian, all that.
Okay.
All that. So,
everything in your group, everything in public works.
Correct.
Okay.
Everything in public works, but not parks. Parks has a little bit different matrix they use.
Yeah.
One of the biggest things is the safety definition. And if I go to this other tab, this dives more into the safety calculations. I'll just show it to you, but it gives you an idea of the average daily traffic, the average collisions per year, you get a collision rate. If it's above or below that the statewide collision rate, it either qualifies as a safety project or not, those kinds of things. And then, of course, there's all sorts of scoring items related to each of those categories as considered, if it's considered a safety project. We can get more into that detail, but I'll just get, you know, just let you know kind of this is one of the categories you look at that has a lot of heavy data that, and that's why we haven't applied this to all the projects, because it is time consuming to calculate and get all this data. So as we get more into projects and we think we're getting into ones that we're interested in, we can add this information and add this to the matrix for those projects. And just save us some workload, I guess, you know, instead of doing it for every project right now. But that's one item. And then, of course, you have, there's several different things here. And I think this was mentioned before, the land, water, and transportation plan was, you know, is it in that plan that we have? And I think we're going to discuss that maybe next week. There's also the Campo plan or the Travis County blueprint, which is a long-range planning document. Is it in there? Here's a category, is it included in the Parks Master Plan, or is it in the Colorado River Corridor Plan? There's all sorts of different plans we have. You get more points the more plans you're associated with, things like that.
And did you, I can't recall, David, were these, like, were certain aspects of these weighted more heavily? Like, if it's in a master plan, it gets a greater weight than, you know, if it's
right. We didn't, when we did this last time, it was, you know, how many columns did it touch? The more columns it touched, the higher the ranking got. Now, some of them were tied. You know, you get five of them that are tied, and then you have to kind of look at what has more significance to the community, okay, things like that. But it's not an exact science in this, but it gives you a general feel for, you know, is this project touching multiple plans? Is it in line with what we want to do with other plans that we've accepted or adopted? Is it safety? Does it have safety issues with it? You know, things like that. The safety definitions really went into a lot of detail on scoring, and not just did it click a box or not. It was based on accident rates and things like that. But the rest of these categories are just, we just looked at, did it check that box? If it checked six boxes and the other ones checked five, then you're up above them. Okay. So pretty simple. But there are a lot of different columns you can look at. And then we might be adding some new ones, you know, for an equity lens and things like that. So, you know, be thinking of different additional columns we could add that you think might be of importance. There's quite a few columns on here, so, oops, sorry.
Are these the evaluation criteria that the bond committee used, or are these the evaluation criteria that staff had to pre-filter and come up with a list to begin with?
This is what staff used to create a ranking order of those projects from last time. We ranked, we had, gosh, I don't know how many projects, and we had to try and rank them as much as we could. And so that's all that was for it. Now, the CBAC committee kind of looked at those rankings, and it helped them formulate what they thought was more important. But in no way are we saying that these are definitely the highest priority projects. It's just based on the criteria we had, we proposed this in a ranking that we used. Like I said, we can play with this all you want. We can add columns, take them out. I might try and clean up some of these columns that I know are no longer really applicable if we want to start using this process. But give you an idea, the projects that we highlighted on that project list, the ones we highlighted in green, We didn't really quite look at this priority matrix that we use. We looked at more of, we're trying to do more regional projects with so much growth in the county. And because of the 2017, we did a lot of small projects, a lot of drainage, little smaller ones, that we took care of most of those. So now we need to start focusing, we believe, on more arterial, regional, impactful projects, which are larger projects, but has a pretty huge impact for a larger percent of the community. That also reduces the number of projects that in staff has to work on, and so that helps us because it's a lot. You know, if you have $1 million, but you have about 20 projects, compared to $1 million with just two projects, it's going to be a lot easier on staff to manage two projects, even though they're more expensive. Every small project almost has about the same amount of workload as you would with a larger project. So that's why we're proposing, for two reasons, the projects we have is they're more regional in nature, larger projects, easier for the for our staff to manage as well. But if we do start getting multiple projects, we will have to supplement our staff with outside consultants probably.
I wanted to add to that, John, just real quick.
Yeah, please.
I just wanted to add that, you know, we fully agree that regional, at least at the staff level, that biggest bang for the buck, right? I mean, we're trying to do a lot of good with a limited number of resources and time and staff availability. That is not to say that there won't be a few projects that you see on the list or you hear from the constituents, as small as it may be very impactful for that particular neighborhood or area of town. So definitely do not rule those out. Just understand that there may be a level of effort that's still going to be comparable to a big project. But if it's worthy for, you know, and you guys feel that's a good recommendation, by all means, that's something you guys should consider. It will just be a difference of, you know, having to move staff resources into something like that. Not that we can't. David made a good point. We can supplement with general engineering contractors if we need to, and we have. We have at our disposal at least probably one DEC, and the CTRMA has graciously agreed to continue doing projects with us. So those, with that and existing staff, you know, we did about 50 plus projects in the 2017 bond.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. And you know, one thing, if we do start getting communities coming in, you'll probably notice that it's going to be mostly pedestrian projects or bicycle projects. That's why I mentioned too, if we do a pedestrian project, if a constituent comes in and says it's needed, well, we typically like to get the homeowners association backing that request as well, because it will become very controversial once you start trying to put that sidewalk in. Just keep that in the back of your head.
Yeah, for sure. And you know, obviously there's a bit of a zero-sum game component to all of this. To the extent we add one project, you know, it's going to entail us dropping another. Because if you just look at those columns, you know, you can see we're already well beyond, you know, the 350 to 450 million that, you know, we've been tasked to work with. So can you maybe start with transportation and you know, go to the transportation tab instead of the consolidated?
Yeah, this is actually the safety data.
Oh, it's just the safety. Yeah. Okay, so the rest of it's all.
Yeah, it does have a lot of data on it, but it's hard when you're zoomed in too. You can't see everything. It does have some bicycle safety projects in here too, to see if it qualified for any safety issues. You know, so here we got some columns that were related to. Let's see. Based on traffic data, well, I guess we'd have to get into it more if we really want to start exploring the different scoring mechanisms we used.
Yeah, no, and so I can't remember the names of the projects because I haven't studied the list yet. Is this 2017 projects or is this ours?
This is 2017.
Okay, these are all 2017 projects.
Got it. And what you'll notice on the large project list, if it says new on those projects, that means that they've been added since 2017 CBAC committee was held. And so we have several projects that have numbers for ranking right now on that master project list, but some of them will say new, and that gives you an idea of which ones have been added.
So that's really just a function of how long they've been around.
Correct, right.
And will we be applying safety criteria to all of the projects, or are some, they don't really have a safety aspect that's would be a meaningful driver of?
I think it's a good matrix scoring tool that okay. you could use for all the projects.
Okay.
Now, not all projects will qualify for safety criteria, and we do have a list of safety criteria that we said if it meets one of these seven criteria, then it's a safety project. And so we can apply this scoring to every single project, and some just may not get that safety score because it didn't qualify.
So could we maybe go to parks? I'm assuming parks will be just the criteria associated with parks, and just kind of start to see where you're.
Right, so we have what Charles mentioned earlier, the Parks Master Plan. You know, is it on the Parks Master Plan? Land, Water, Transportation Plan, the LWTP, those sort of things. So there's not as many columns on here, but they're definitely important to parks. And that's what they were using for their ranking.
So can you go back up again? Let's see.
I haven't looked at this too closely. I don't know if some of these.
So Charles, on that, you know, you've got $200 million associated with land acquisition. Are we going to be able to, you know, look at those, apply whatever criteria we're talking about to that? I'm assuming there's got to be some means of, you know, applying some criteria, especially because, you know, $200 million is arguably half of, you know, the entire bond package. You know, so how would we be able to evaluate that?
You know, in prior bond elections, we had properties under option with the Nature Conservancy. And so it was easy, you know, for like Reimers, and we did Reimers both one and phase one and two, those were under option, and we could advertise, hey, these projects are, you know, you vote on this project, you're gonna be voting to buy Reimers Ranch. We're still working on some tracks that we have not been able to put under option, and so we really don't want to advertise at this stage. It would kind of make negotiations kind of go in a direction that doesn't benefit the county.
Yeah.
And you'd get a lot of, you know, people coming in from outside beating up the property, and, you know, so until we get there, I mean, Nature Conservancy is working on several tracks right now. But, you know, some of that money is also conservation easements that, you know, we work on over the course of time. We get willing landowners that want to get a conservation easement on their property, and the property is in an area that we want to preserve. We use conservation easements to buy buffers, lands around our parks, but we also use it to preserve agricultural operations, you know. Businesses that families can stay in their ag business, and you know, with land values they're going through the roof here in Travis County, trying to protect the farms. That's what we try to do with some of that money. So we're not going to be able to go in and say we're going to do this until we can get some properties optioned, and that's what the Nature Conservancy is working on for us.
Yeah, and I guess, you know, somehow we're going to need to come up with a means of, you know, somehow I guess it's something you ought to think on, and I know that all of us are going to want to think on is, you know, how do you, you know, how do you decide to not do other projects where you understand all the needs associated with that and instead allocate, you know, a big chunk to parks and open space that you, you know, if you don't have a description of the advantages associated with the specific expenditure of money, acknowledging that, you know, in real estate acquisition, you know, when you're still trying to buy something, that you have to be very careful about identifying a specific parcel that you don't have an option on, so the price isn't locked in yet.
Right.
So somehow we're going to have to be able to, you know, have some type of criteria to evaluate, you know, the value of that to the citizens of Travis County relative to everything else. Because again, for us, this is a zero-sum game. You know, if we put $200 million towards parks and open space land acquisition, you know, that's, we've got $2.5 billion of needs. You know, that's $200 million of other projects, whether it's parks projects or, you know, road, drainage, ped, mm-hmm. bicycle projects that aren't getting done. So,
yeah. It's a dilemma.
I mean,
Travis County, I will tell you that of all the counties in Central Texas, did get out ahead of the development pressures that have gone on, and has done, great work preserving, you know, lands around the county.
Totally.
And I, you know, kudos to Williamson County. Williamson County has done the same. But some of the other adjacent counties like Bastrop and Hayes and Blanco, they didn't catch the wave.
Yeah.
And they missed the opportunity. And, you know, and I honestly think, you know, Travis County probably has, you know, maybe this bond election, maybe one more before our opportunities to buy a Reimers type ranch or a Gilliland Creek Greenway project that goes from, you know, Pflugerville all the way to Colorado River. I think those are going to be lost.
Yeah, no, please, Gary.
So, Charles, that was the 2017 criteria. Do you, looking at that list, do you think that there's anything more that, that y'all would want to include in it for this round of project selection?
You know, honestly, you're asking me right now. I need to talk to my staff and have us kind of, you know, ruminate on it and then come back to you guys and talk to you in more specifics.
Totally understand that. And I'd appreciate the chance to have those plus the road ones also, just to absorb them a little bit.
Yeah, no, we'll get those. Yeah. And that's what I had mentioned, that they're going to send us this. So we'll be able to really start, you know, look at it and think and ruminate on it. Exactly.
Yeah. John, they've been added to the teams folder, so that's more impetus for you guys to get into your teams.
So it's already there.
So I'll just, sitting here today, I'll just ask for consideration of connectivity to existing protected mm-hmm. lands in some way. You know, I know there's the extension of facilities, but, you know, conservation easement next to a conservation easement, for example, would be something of personal interest to me.
I mean, I can give you kind of an example. When we started buying land on Wilbarger Creek, I think we were paying $4,000 to $6,000 an acre for floodplain, and now it's $40,000 to $60,000 an acre. And that's the case on the east side of the county because of, you know, Tesla and all the high tech companies coming in, kind of up in Hutto and what have you. It's just the land values have gone crazy, but we're not quite there yet on finishing our targeted acquisitions.
Yeah, and I know that was, you know, a critical catalyst for this bond advisory committee coming together, which, you know, Judge Brown and we talked about earlier, is it's going to be lost to development and or, you know, unaffordable land prices in short order. So, but I still, you know, as you think of things, and so I hope everybody in here will, you know, pull that list up, look at those criteria, and y'all had mentioned several, and I hope the ones that y'all had mentioned that you, other things you thought would be important to evaluate projects by, that you'll start making notes of those, because we're, next time we're really going to kind of move into that level of detail. And, you know, Charles, I would say that even if you didn't talk about, you know, a specific piece of property, if you could talk about, like, what the benefit of those places, because you've got the land in mind, you know, it's just, it's the public acknowledgement of it, that, you know, you can still talk in general terms about what that does, you know, protect waterways, you know, provide a buffer to an existing park, preserve critical open space for flora, fauna, or whatever is important, you know, connectivity to other things. I mean, there's a lot of reasons to justify that. So maybe it's in general terms that, you know, this $100 million meets this criteria.
Right.
And, you know, we'll have to maybe make peace with the fact that we won't know specifically, or we won't be able to talk about publicly what, you know, what individual piece of ground that is. But it's the type of thing, I know a lot of y'all are in here for the sake of, you know, parks and open space. That's been a long-term commitment that y'all have been involved with, so I hope you'll think in those terms, because we have to have some kind of justification to, you know, not only allocate from the roadside over to the park side, but then also allocate within the park side to land acquisition. There just has to be some there for us to do that. Yeah, please, Cody. Let's do Cody, and then we'll go to you, Rajiv.
Do I need to? Is there at least some way to? Okay. Would there be some way to at least give some range of, you know, acquisition costs for different areas of the county, and just so we kind of get a sense of, like, the distribution of price? Because I assume Western Travis County would be significantly higher per acre than East. And I'm just trying to think of some other inputs and drivers that might help us, without naming names, help us kind of make decisions based on some harder facts, and, you know, what are we getting in certain areas? You know, just another layer of data to kind of consider.
Like you mean, like, in terms of number of acres? Is that what you're?
Yeah, you know, what's, you know, we can roughly just get, I don't want to target any particular area, but, you know, just so we have some guesstimation of, if we're going to pick up 100 acres in Northeast Travis County, you know, we're looking at this price range per acre.
Sure.
You know, there's, you know, I don't want to get into it tonight because it's, I don't even know if it would work, but, you know, and what are some of these scenarios, places that we could use for, wastewater is going to be a huge issue for these growing communities outside of Austin. I mean, are there ways to layer other uses of in these park areas or conservation easements? I'm really free-forming here publicly, sorry. But, you know, I'm just trying to think of some different data points that might be more utilitarian in nature as we kind of think through the park issue.
Sure.
Rajiv?
Yeah, following along what you're saying, and before that, you know, what you were saying, John, and just looking at these criteria, I'm just going to share a reaction I had, and I submit it for your reaction and anybody else from the staff. All of these criteria have to do with engineering cost, whether they're part of a plan or not. They don't seem to get into the impact on the community. They don't talk about, you know, how many dollars saved or how many lives touched. You know, maybe the safety one gets in there a little bit. But what's the impact? You know, when you do a project, there's a cost-benefit, right, analysis. So unless it's a compliance project, you know, when it's a mandated thing. But if there are elective projects, you would have to have some sense of the benefit that drove that project or that might drive that project, you know, like savings or quality of life or something along those lines. And I just feel like they're not represented, at least not without staring at them very hard. I don't see them as reflecting on the benefit side at all. They're just on the cost side and compliance side. Like, if they're part of a plan, that means you're inheriting the priority that something else had. So yes, that's a good thing, but it doesn't directly address what the community, you know, might want to look for. Like, is it really benefiting, and who is it benefiting? When we come to equity, that's another issue that would come up.
Yep.
So can you or anybody else just talk about the benefit side of the equation for these projects, not just the cost side?
I think Cynthia wants to comment. Rajiv, let me just kind of preface that. What you see with the plans that are listed there are because we have spent, you know, significant time in, like, for example, land, water, transportation plan, defining what those things are about each of those that will benefit the community. The blueprint talks about connectivity, north, south, east, west. The Parks Master Plan talks about being able to deliver services across the entire county, regional. Some are very specific to that part of town. Like, you're talking west, you're going to talk lakes. We're talking about metropolitan parks for youth. So we will put all of those wonderful plans in your Teams channel so that you guys can look at that, because it talks about what brought us to those plans, the benefits that you're talking about, which are very, very important. I agree. I think that's something that this group is heading towards, is what is the public benefit? What is the outcome? I love the phrase, how many lives are reached or impacted. I think that will give you a better idea, not necessarily the criteria you will land on, but it gives you a better idea of how we got to those rankings within that particular group.
Great. And if we have the priority in those plans for each of these projects exposed, then that makes it easier to understand what level of priority it was in each of these plans.
I don't think there's a priority for everything that you're going to find in those plans.
Okay.
They identify those things that the court has approved as being important to the community as a whole. I don't think there's any weighting in any of those, perhaps in the Lynn Water Transportation Plan to some extent. But you're not, I wish it could be a nice mathematical formula for you, but it isn't. And there's a lot of discussion this group should have about, you know, those plans are written at a point in time.
Right.
They are being updated. So, some of those criteria may be different for you all now based on where we are today.
And I would just say, that when y'all load those up, you know, it's incumbent upon us to read those. But we'll also have, you know, make sure Charles presents the master plan and he'll walk us through it so we can understand it. And it'll do some of, maybe it'll satisfy, it's a great answer because, of course, you know, staff has considered those type of things. That's the place they've done it. Maybe it'll satisfy, you know, your questions, maybe it won't, but that's the whole point of you being here.
I mean, all of these projects, I'm sure, are very high impact, very beneficial projects.
Yeah.
But when we are being asked to rank them to each other, we just need to know what those benefits are.
I was going to go there with
one more comment related to what you were saying. Once we have those benefits identified, and then with the narrative that you laid out, right, you know, does it preserve connectivity? And you mentioned four or five just off the top of your head, things, the benefits that come from the land acquisition projects. If those could be enumerated, then we start to compare, okay, here is this benefit, and here was that benefit.
Right.
Otherwise, like you said, it's comparing apples and oranges, and the committee will just struggle to, you know, other than on emotional grounds, which is fine. we're hoping to do better than that.
Great point. That's why you're here. Dr. Wallace?
Two questions. One's a legal question. Since we're in the Open Meetings Act, in understanding land acquisition and how that all impacts, is that something that can be utilized under executive session where we can have more of a specific discussion on potential land acquisitions and then it can be alluded to back in the open meeting?
Yeah, and James had asked that exact same
question. Oh, he did? Okay.
Yeah, he did. Right. So
if it already got covered.
Great minds think alike. No, not before you arrived. He had just written a note.
Oh, okay.
Same thing. So
that's the one question. And I had a follow-up. You already gave the thought process I was having regarding impacts and
general about the benefits of conservation easements, the general
Yeah. Okay, fully understandable. And then back to what Rajiv was talking about, definitely I know for myself, looking at whether it's parks or whether it's roads and so forth, again, what is that actual impact by population number, right? Because it could be a road that seems insignificant, and I know you used the word arterial. I'm not sure if you gave the definition of what arterial is and how crucial an arterial is to relieve traffic on the main highways, right? And something like that could have a significant impact to the lives and the populations more so than another project. And so I'm not sure how much legwork that would require in trying to identify roads and parks and so forth, which you believe the impact would be, because it already sounds like that's a lot of what you were just talking about as part of the guesstimation process of all of this, is what is perceived to be more impactful than another, regardless of the amount of money or regardless of the size and so forth.
Yeah, you know, and one thing that we do, you know, to somewhat towards that is we do look at the traffic volumes of a roadway. That gives you an idea of how many people are traveling that road and how many people will be affected by a roadway. So that, you know, that's something to think about too, but yeah, there could be several other criteria we could utilize for that. And then also I'm wondering, would it be beneficial to this group if we had our long range planning division to come and talk about the Travis County blueprint, which talks about the arterials and the future network plan for the county?
Yes.
Would that be helpful?
Because my concern is sometimes if we're just going off of the what's in the plan, if it's in the Cap Metro plan, if it's in the Campo plan, there have been times that roads are not in the plans because those cities, those municipalities are just not a part of that conversation, or they didn't get a piggyback from TxDOT or someone else, so that's why they're not there, even though they may be a high priority of impact for those cities or those extraterritorial jurisdictions.
Yeah, so hang on to that, Dr. Wallace. So we're gonna, you know, move through this. We've got 1 minute, Andy. I want to sure and get to you.
Real
and we're, you know, we're not done with this discussion. So
now, real quickly, I'd like to kind of add to that. With the anticipation that Austin area, Travis County is supposed to double in population by 2040. Is there a way, and I know this is a crystal ball question, but is there a way to look at these projects on future land use as well? You know, how are these going to touch not just what's today, but what we're projecting? So for instance, you know, out in western Travis County with the massive growth out 71 towards Spicewood and Bee Cave, Lakeway, all that area, you know, prices of land versus how many people, you know, same thing out, you know, towards Elgin and Manor. I mean, the growth, so that we can kind of look at these projects and say, okay, this road right now may be a little bit off the beaten path, but we're anticipating, you know, anticipation by the time the next bond project in 6 years from now, we're going to have another 15,000 people out here.
Yeah. Yeah. So great. Don't, you know, obviously hang on to that as we develop our criteria. So if everybody can make it a point to, at a minimum, you know, look at those criteria list and really start to think about it and all these questions that we're asking in here, see if they're answered there, you know, and start making a list of things that, you know, this is the dialogue we're going to have to come up with a list of what we're going to, how we're going to evaluate the projects and move them in or out. And then we're going to start in on the projects, you know, and they'll say, all right, this is where this is. Here's the application of the criteria that y'all have come up with. You know, here's how it checks out. And I think it's a good place. What we'll, so next time we'll probably start with the Parks Master Plan and just give us a sense of that, and then maybe move back to the criteria again. And then maybe we'll shift to roads at some point. Also, we are working on the overall timeline of our entire time together. So we'll start to come up with some dates relatively quickly of when we'll hold meetings out around the county, when we'll tour the projects. Cynthia's got something to say in that respect.
Yeah, so that was my homework, which I didn't complete on time, but I spent a good portion of this meeting with one ear on the meeting and trying to put together the timeline. You have a lot of open time frames between March and April, so John, I'm not sure how, you know, it depends on what the agenda is going to be, but somewhere in that time frame, I think between March and April, you'd want to do your project tours. You'll have some better idea of what projects you're interested in. You may not have a list yet, but the ones, maybe that's how we do it. Think about how you guys want to, which projects you're particularly interested in. We'll see how we can structure those tours. Typically, they're on a Saturday. And, you know, we'll, depending on how they're, the projects you guys want to visit, shake out, we'll figure out logistics at that point in time. We usually, I think, have done two different groups. Doesn't have to be that way. But, and then I will say the thing that I'm looking at based on the June 6th court date is that you will need to do public meetings roughly the first couple of weeks in May. And then have the third week in May to kind of discuss what that's going to be. That's taking in just general public meetings, and then a second round of that specific outreach that Commissioner Shea mentioned about those folks that we could potentially be impacting with those specific projects that you're thinking of recommending. So more targeted outreach the week after, and then the third week, kind of wrapping up all the input and finalizing your report and getting your agenda ready for court on June 6th. It really needs to be done by May 31st.
So I will work with, you know, Cynthia and Sydney to sort of come up with the first draft of this, you know, so y'all don't have to suffer through every iteration of all of the issues associated with this time frame. And then we'll roll this back out maybe next meeting if we're ready. And, you know, that's something we're going to have to talk about, make sure that y'all are satisfied. We're doing enough outreach. The timing works for everybody, that, you know, the timing of the outreach is consistent with how knowledgeable we're going to be, you know. So a lot of different variables, but plenty of time to input, but I won't make y'all suffer through every iteration of it. Well, thanks a lot, David and Charles. You know, you can kind of start to get a feel for what we're going to be doing. You know, so it's the much more fun part of the process. If no further questions, assuming no objections, we'll adjourn. Thank you, everybody.